cryptocurrency mining. I get asked by a lot of people about what is this about? Why do we need it? Why do we need to do it? Cryptocurrencies have evolved. There's over 1,000 different cryptocurrencies on the market now. It's still very high risk and very volatile, something that you need to be very careful with. But from a mining aspect, there's two different paths you can take. Path number one is to go with the ASIC dedicated miners to mine Bitcoin, because Bitcoin is kind of the gold standard of cryptocurrencies, and it's something that a lot of people recognize. It's got a lot of recognition since it first started in 2009. Bitcoin mining uses a system called SHA-256, and this system is mining a cryptographic algorithm. So what you're doing is you're contributing to the blockchain, and the blockchain is kind of a public ledger system. So the problem is, even though we've already mined over 80% of the Bitcoins right now, and they feel, well, you know, what's the point? The point is that you will always need mining, because you will always require people to contribute to the blockchain, because the blockchain is what's keeping track of any single time a transaction is performed when it comes to Bitcoin transactions or any cryptocurrency transaction. So if you're going to send money from one wallet to another wallet, these are digital wallets online, you need to verify that information and permanently write it in the public ledger system, which is the blockchain. So even after you've mined 100% of the cryptocurrency and you're not making any more, which you were gaining from rewards, the system still needs to be able to verify and record all of the transactions that occur. So then the second type of mining that you can do is a system called ERC-20 tokens. And that the biggest one there that you've heard, kind of the gold standard on that side, is Ethereum. So we've got other coins like Litecoin, Ripple, and Dash, and a whole bunch. Like literally there's over 1,000 different cryptocurrencies. Ethereum uses different processors. So it's not an ASIC based, which is like a single purpose computer that all it can do is crunch through Bitcoins. No, in this case, you're using high-end graphics cards, GPUs. So this is the kind of stuff that gamers are used to. That's why right now, if you go into a lot of hardware manufacturing stores to go and buy computer parts, a lot of them are sold out of power supplies and graphics cards. It's because of all the people that have been jumping on, going and doing mining, specifically for the Ethereum and other kinds of coins and tokens based on that. So now mining from that purpose is running, again, a lot of electricity, a lot of cooling. But I think the interesting part about this, to me, I think it's kind of neat, is that you're not using a single purpose computer, that the only thing you can do is mine Bitcoins. You're actually using computers, parts, in this case, graphic cards, high-end graphic cards, which are gonna have a value at some point. Now, the interesting thing is you're setting up these computers to have multiple graphics cards. It's not just each computer has one graphics card and one power supply. No, actually quite the opposite. Mining specific motherboards that you can get that have up to 13 or even 19 slots for graphics cards that can connect to it, so that you're actually using 19 different GPUs at the same time on the same system for mining. And they don't even all need to match. You can use different programs out there, like one called Claymore, which can mine Ethereum and other coins. But the interesting thing about that is that if you ever decided, you know what, this is just not profitable anymore, my electricity is too expensive, the difficulty of mining has gone up too much, and I just don't want to do this anymore, not all is lost. It's not like you've invested a whole bunch in hardware that is not recoverable. You can actually take those high-end graphics cards, these GPUs, and sell those afterwards to gamers or to AutoCAD people or people who need essentially high-end graphics cards for the computers. Now, depending on the climate you live in and the environment you're in, you do have to consider that the power is going to be a problem. So kind of getting into it a little bit more, imagine a computer that has multiple video cards. Well, most power supplies only can support a certain number of 6 or 8 pin power leads for feeding those high-end graphics cards. And because of that, you're not only limited by the amount of power that the power supply can put out, whether you can even plug it into a regular household 15 amp circuit, but you're also limited to the number of video cards that you can actually connect to each power supply. So for example, a mining rig that I have running has 13 cards on it, but it's split over 4 power supplies with roughly a balance of 3 to 4 video cards per power supply. And then 2 of the power supplies are connected to a regular household outlet. So you need 2 household outlets. Now, power costs throughout the world are different by country. And of course, climates are different by country depending on whether you're in a cool climate or a warm climate. And then knowing that the byproduct of running this all the time is heat, because you're putting off a huge amount of heat that needs to be cooled off of these devices, you're probably better off to do this in countries that have lower power costs and that are generally cooler by nature, you know, on the average over throughout the year. So mining in general is something that's high risk, highly volatile market, and you have to decide, do you really want to jump into that space? Like, what is your goal? And even if you, in a lot of countries, they're becoming regulated and you need to report, even for tax purposes, the profit that you're making on what you're mining from your rig. And then you have to decide, how am I going to convert that to fiat currency? So how do you actually take something online, unless you're reinvesting it in something else, other cryptocurrencies, or buying stuff using cryptocurrencies? How are you converting that into actual money or taking it out, if assuming that you wanted to pay back your initial investment? So the big calculation that a lot of people need to do is understanding, what is the hashing rate? How fast the cryptographic calculations that your mining rig can do, and you total that up over all of your graphics cards or your ASICs that you're doing if you're doing dedicated mining on the Bitcoin side. And this is typically measured in terahashes or gigahashes. And there's calculators online that allow you to put in what your power consumption is, your power costs are, your original hardware investment, and what the current rate is. But being that it's a highly volatile market, what do you base the actual cryptocurrency that you're earning? So that can change and fluctuate within a day. There's huge spikes, ups and downs on the cryptocurrencies themselves. The next problem is that because of all the people who are mining, you're going to have increased difficulty. So that means that every 2 weeks on Bitcoin side, the difficulty is adjusted, and that's based on how fast the prior 2 weeks was achieved. So the typical transaction to the blockchain is supposed to take 10 minutes. If the average transaction over 2 weeks takes less than 10 minutes, it's going to make it more difficult for the next 2 week period, which means there's more people who are mining. The total hashing rate globally is very high, higher than the prior 2 weeks, and therefore the payout that you're going to get for your share, your contribution of your hashing rate, is going to be a lot lower. Now, where people are hoping is that over time, the cryptocurrency itself is increasing in value. But, you know, this is just like a stock, and bad things can happen. So you really have to take into play and account for all of these different factors that come in. So it's not just, okay, I've got an initial hardware investment. Can I even get the hardware? Because a lot of it is sold out right now, and you can't even get your hands on it. Do you have the right power supply? Do you have the right adapters? Once you build it, are you monitoring this thing? Unless you're going with a single-purposed one, which is for Bitcoin only, where are you going to place this thing? Is it too loud? Is it going to put off too much heat? Are you going to need special power for it? Can you afford the power that is going to it? Is it going to go into some kind of different digital wallet? And how are you going to convert that or use that and report that to the different regulation and tax authorities that are applicable for your region? All of this needs to be investigated and decided before you go and jump on the bandwagon. One of the easiest forms of mining right now, and it's not really profitable, but if you just want to have some fun, is something called Monero. And interestingly, you've probably heard of a new form of malware or spyware that's infecting people's computers called cryptojacking. Now, cryptojacking is where you're being displayed ads on YouTube or on a website pop-up, or maybe it's you're running some kind of Chrome extension piece of software that you've installed on your computer, and you don't realize it, but all of a sudden your computer's CPU, the main processing unit for your computer, so again, not a graphics card, the computer itself is actually mining this Monero coin. Now, for cryptojacking, it's going to somebody else's wallet. You're not even making that. Somebody else is using your computer resources nefariously to make themselves some money. But if you wanted to try it out yourself, you could try out Monero, run it on your computer, see what you think, and experiment with, you know, the thought of having a digital wallet, mining a cryptocurrency, seeing a taste of how much the hashing rate for that is and how much you earn within a 24-hour period, and just kind of dipping your feet just to see what is this mining thing about and what do I do with it. Then have another friend go and set up a digital wallet as well and learn how to transfer money between each other. Because now when you go and transfer money between digital wallets, people don't realize that you get charged transaction fees. And the transaction fees are a portion of the cryptocurrency that's going to be charged to you, shaved off the amount that you're transferring in order for that transaction to be logged into the blockchain so that it's being basically written into the general ledger, which we call the blockchain technology. Another fascinating thing that I find, I think it's coming in the future, and why I kind of see a lot of sex appeal to the entire Ethereum network are the distributed application programs, the dApps, that people can go and basically run on the Ethereum network. I mean, think about this. You've got all these computers around the world who are contributing and running mining on Ethereum. So they're contributing to this cryptographic algorithm. But could you imagine having that and being able to run programs on it? It's kind of like a supercomputer at your fingertips that you can rent time on. And I think that has a lot of future potential. So on that note, this is all to explain to you that there are a lot of risks, a lot of costs, and a lot of factors involved in getting into cryptocurrency mining, and it's something that you should seriously investigate, and maybe just don't jump in feet first by going out and investing a whole bunch into this. I think you need to investigate it, and maybe just try it out a little bit with something like the Monero coin or whatever it might be. So that's some information for you on cryptocurrency mining.